This is a copyrighted work. Unauthorized copying or distribution is a crime punishable by up to 5 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Scholastic Audio presents Rwby, Fairy Tales of Remnant by E.C. Myers, based on the series created by Monty Ohm. Read by Jesse Vilinsky, with Shannon McCormick as Professor Ozpin.
Introduction. Remnant has a very long history, and yet we do not know much about its ancient past. We have many questions, and never all the answers we would like. But we do have stories. Whether they're true stories passed down through the ages or myths defying time itself, our stories help explain who we are and why we're here. They give us solace when we need it, advice if we seek it, and connections that bind us together as one people. If you don't believe in stories, if you can't accept their truths, then you will always seek and never find. When I became headmaster of Beacon Academy, one of my first goals was to introduce a deeper study of the stories that make up the fabric of our world. After all, I am first and foremost a teacher. The volume in your hands has been a pet project of mine for many years. I have traveled around Remnant to collect these fairy tales, myths, and fables from recent memory and distant times. I have discovered in this lifelong pursuit that if you wish to fully appreciate a story, you should consider its source and attempt to unravel and understand the storyteller's intentions. Why did they tell this story? Why now? Yes, stories may be shared for entertainment alone. However, they also can disguise lessons, moral guidance, important historic records, moon-shattering revelations, and even dire warnings of hidden dangers in the world and difficult trials yet to come. It may seem self-serving to place this book at the core of a new curriculum at the Huntsman Academies. However, it has also been compiled with these academies especially in mind. Our students hail from all over Remnant, from all four kingdoms, and even some outlying regions. Each one brings a unique perspective to their studies, influenced by personal experiences, as well as those lived vicariously through others. I believe it is important and instructive to provide a common frame of reference, representing our diverse backgrounds and cultures, for us all to share. School is where young huntsmen in training will figure out the world and find their place in it, but stories, too, have served this noble purpose since long before the first academy was built. Because an appreciation of history is vital to preparing for our future, I have always found value in continuing and creating school traditions at Beacon Academy. If this collection is embraced as a cherished school tradition, I will be proud to have played some small part in that legacy. There are few things I can be certain of in this world, but I do know that stories like those collected here will always endure and illuminate. If we are fortunate, people will continue to tell our stories long after we are gone, and remember us. Above all, it is always my hope that you as students, and we as people, will take time to listen to others' stories, share our own, and hold in our hearts the lessons we learn from both. Professor Ozpin.
The Warrior in the Woods, as recorded by Glinda Goodwitch. There was once a village on the edge of a lush forest, known far and wide as the safest place in the land. The evil creatures of Grimm had not attacked there since long before anyone could remember, and it was said that the woods themselves protected the people from harm. As long as no one dared to enter the charmed forest, it would keep the monsters at bay. The people went about their days with carefree spirits, and the village gradually grew as more people arrived to live in peace. Over time, the people grew complacent in their ways, taking their fortune for granted and trusting they would always be safe and happy. The village children began playing games inside the woods, though they never ventured too far. After all, they'd never even seen a Grimm outside a storybook. One day, a boy was playing hide-and-seek with his friends in the woods. He ventured farther inside than ever before, farther than anyone would ever think to look for him. He waited and waited, alone in the gloomy forest. As night fell, the boy heard the woods come alive with the sounds of flapping wings, skittering insects, and rustling leaves. But he had never been afraid of the dark before, and he had always been curious about the forest. So instead of returning home to a hot meal and a warm fire, he wandered deeper into the trees. The boy soon found his way into a moonlit clearing, and there something found him. He first saw its four glowing red eyes, then the stark white of its long, sharp, curved tusks. This was the largest creature the boy had ever seen, and its pitch-black hair was seemingly made of the night itself. He screamed. The boy couldn't help it, for he had never seen anything like the Grimm. For the first time in his life, he knew fear, and he felt sure he was about to die. The creature whirled on him, fixed the boy in its burning gaze, and charged. The boy froze, throwing his arms up in front of him and squeezing his eyes shut. But then, as he braced for the worst, something shoved him aside. He tumbled away through loose dirt, stones, and leaves, and when he looked up, he saw a tall, fair woman in a flowing black cape facing off against the Grimm. She gripped a long-handled billhook with both hands. The boy was stunned to see the boar-like Grimm turn to run away from her. The woman charged after it, her bladed staff spinning so fast that it blurred. Just before she caught up to the Grimm, the woman planted the butt end of the weapon into the earth and vaulted feet first into the air. As she soared over the creature, she turned in midair, sweeping the hooked blade down and slicing through the Grimm. It squealed and split in two. When the woman landed, she pivoted to face the Grimm again, but the broken pieces only puffed into thick black smoke and floated away. She spun the billhook once more and holstered it on her back. "Go home. You never saw me," she told the boy, turning to leave. The boy jumped up. "Wait," he said. His ankle was sprained, but he hobbled after the woman, grimacing. She paused and looked back. And that was the first time he truly saw her. She was as beautiful as she was fierce. Up close, he saw her black cloak was threadbare, its hem tattered, tears throughout it mended with fraying red thread. Her loose gray blouse might have been white once, and her leggings were covered in mismatched patches. Her hair was almost as dark as the Grimm's, white hairs standing out as brightly as bone. The metal hook on her weapon was chipped, and a crack was beginning to split the long wooden handle. "Thank you," he said simply. She nodded and continued to move away. "At least tell me your name," he called after her. But she disappeared into the trees. The boy limped home. He didn't tell anyone about the warrior woman who had saved him, but he described the terrible monster he had narrowly escaped. Those who believed him took his safe return as proof that the woods protected them, and they continued living as they had. But the boy had seen the truth, so he watched the woods with caution, always remembering the woman. And he wondered, who was she, and why had she saved him? Was it she that kept the whole village safe? A year later, the boy returned to the clearing in the woods, and then he dared to go beyond it. Even during the day, it was dark amid the trees, and after some time, he realized he was being followed. A sense of dread overcame him, and when he looked over his shoulder, He saw two bright yellow eyes flaring in the shadows. He drew a dagger from his belt and only faltered when the creature crashed through the trees and howled before him. This grim had a gruesome, bony mask, and it was sharp all over. Sharp teeth, sharp spikes, sharp claws. It bounded toward him on four massive paws, its hind legs built for speed and power. The boy raised his dagger, but it was almost as useless as if he had been unarmed. He didn't cry out or try to run away. He was frozen in place by fear. Just then, he saw the woman drop from a tree onto the creature's back and hack at its neck with her billhook. Its handle was shorter now, and the boy saw she carried a sharpened stake made from its other broken half. When the grim tried to shake her off, she jammed the stake into one of its eyes. Then she jumped off and watched as the terrible dark wolf toppled backward and dissolved into a cloud of mist. She retrieved the stake, its tip steaming. "Thank you," the boy said, finding his voice. She turned to him. "You again." She shook her head and walked off. The boy felt an unexpected rush of joy. "You remember me?" "I remember everyone I've saved, and everyone I didn't." She paused to look at him. "I see you didn't learn your lesson about coming into my woods." He held up the dagger. "I came prepared." Her laugh was not unkind. "So you're a slow learner. Don't come back. Really." "I came looking for you," he admitted. She narrowed her eyes. "I don't train people to fight anymore."
"It's not that. I brought you something."
The boy pulled off his backpack and held it out to her. She hesitated before coming closer to take it. She wasn't as tall as she had seemed before, and there were more white strands in her hair. But she was still proud and strong, and even more beautiful than he remembered.
"What's this?"
she said as she pulled out a bundle wrapped in dark green cloth. Inside the bundle, there were three blouses like her own, two leggings, a black skirt, new boots, and a short hooded green cloak.
"New clothes," he said.
"Well, not new, really. They were my mother's." Her brief smile faded.
"Did she die?"
the warrior asked.
The boy shook his head. "No, she's fine," he said. "She doesn't wear these anymore. She told me to donate them to someone who needs them, and that's what I'm doing."
The warrior said, "I need nothing, and I can't accept these anyway."
"Why not? It's the least I can do."
"The least you can do is leave and never come back."
"Please," he said.
"All right. If it will make you leave me alone." She wrapped up the clothes, nodded at him, and walked away with his gift. "Next time you enter the woods, you're on your own." When the boy returned the following year, he was now a young man. He moved quietly through the trees, almost as quietly as the warrior woman. So he avoided any encounters with Grimm until he had nearly reached the center of the forest. Leaves rustled over his head as he paused to refresh himself in a shallow stream. Then he looked up to see three oversized, fearsome black owls fixing him in their deadly stare. They spread their wings, revealing razor-sharp feathers and deadly talons. The boy drew a long, thin sword, which he had forged himself under the dubious eye of the village blacksmith, who wondered why anyone would hunt with such a weapon when they could use a bow and arrow or a spear. But the boy had crafted his sword with a special purpose: to fight the hate-filled monsters from his nightmares. The savage bird creatures dived at him, attacking with claws and thundering away with their powerful wings. While he had hoped for the warrior woman to appear, he did not expect it, and indeed she did not come to save him.
It was a long, clumsy, bloody battle. But eventually the young man prevailed over two of the beasts. The third swooped at him. Exhausted, he couldn't bring up his sword in time. Then a brilliant white light flooded the woods. He shielded his eyes, and when the brightness faded, the grim was gone. A moment later, the warrior woman appeared.
"What was that light? Where did it go?"
he asked.
"You're developing a bad habit," she said.
He sheathed his sword and grinned. Was it just wishful thinking, or was she happy to see him? She was wearing a clean white blouse with a black skirt, sturdy boots, and a dark green cloak. Her hair was pulled back into a ponytail. She held her shortened billhook, the end of the broken handle crisscrossed with red ribbon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.